Before we move on to the next item of business, I invite members to join me in welcoming to the gallery Her Excellency Maria Hatterdova, Ambassador of Czechia. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 8981 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on changes to this week's business, and any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 8981 be agreed. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is topical questions. And at question number one, I call Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the reported comments made by the Children and Young People's Commissioner Scotland that the Scottish Government has absolutely failed to deliver for children.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth.
Presiding Officer, I thank Bruce Adamson for all that he has done as Children and Young People's Commissioner, but I do not recognise the picture he paints. This is a government which introduced the game-changing Scottish Child Payment to tackle child poverty. We are delivering 1,140 hours of funded early learning and childcare to all 3- and 4-year-olds and eligible 2-year-olds. We have introduced free bus travel for all under 22s, and we have the most generous provision of free school meal entitlement in any other part of the UK. We are doing all of this, Presiding Officer, as a devolved government within a fixed budget, and despite that, we will continue to make real progress in delivering for our children in what have been and continue to be very challenging times.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. The Children's Commissioner is hugely respected and has long shown his personal and professional commitment to children's and young people's rights, and for that, I'd like to thank him today. He is fundamentally correct in saying the SNP government has failed on its promises to children and young people. They've failed on the attainment gap, on free bikes, child poverty, counselling in schools, free school meals, and the list goes on. So does the Cabinet Secretary accept that it's time for the government to stop patting itself on the back and actually start working to improve the lives of children and young people in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Pam Duncan-Glancy for her response. I too have great respect for Bruce Adamson. In fact, I sat actually on the appointment panel for his appointment back in 2017 when I was a backbencher. Now, the member will appreciate I've been in post for 6 weeks, I think, now. However, I would certainly welcome an opportunity to discuss these matters with the outgoing Children's Commissioner, who I understand will demit office from tomorrow. I've asked to meet with him on the points that he has raised in the press, because fundamentally, the role of the Children's Commissioner is about improving the lives of our young people, and I very much look forward to working constructively with the new Children's Commissioner, Nicola Killeen, when she takes up post later this year. I have to refute some of the suggestions that Ms Duncan-Glancy has made this afternoon, Presiding Officer. But I also think it's important that we have context in this debate, because the latest poverty statistics, for example, published in March, show that Scottish child poverty rates remain 6% lower than in other parts of the UK, so 24% compared to 30% in 2019-22, 31% in England, 28% in Wales and 22% in Northern Ireland, respectively. Those statistics alone cover the period in which the pandemic was having a significant economic impact, but they also show the devastating impact of the UK government's decade of austerity and its welfare cuts for many Scottish families. I think I heard a member from the Conservatives benches say, for heaven's sake. Now, I was listening very intently, actually, to the Children's Commissioner in his interview.
Briefly, Cabinet Secretary, please.
And he mentioned, of course, Philip Alston, the UN's Commissioner, talking about political choices. It was, of course, the UN Special Rapporteur that spoke about the limits of devolution in relation to mitigating Westminster austerity.
Yeah. Pam Duncan-Glancy.
But indeed, context does matter. And whilst the Cabinet Secretary has been in post for 6 weeks, we've had an SNP government here for 16 years. The Commissioner has clearly struck a nerve in his human rights defending. So would the Cabinet Secretary agree that avoiding responsibility for its own shortcomings is why this government has delayed the UNCRC and refused immediate commencement when the bill does come back? Because that is exactly its purpose, to ensure government is truly accountable for upholding children and young people's rights.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I hate to say to Pam Duncan-Glancy, the Scottish Government and the SNP is not actually responsible for COVID, nor are we responsible for the impacts of the cost of living crisis. Ms Duncan-Glancy may wish to look elsewhere in relation to the challenges that's been presented to this government in challenging both of those external factors. And actually, if you listen to what the Children's Commissioner said, he did acknowledge there have been external factors that have placed challenge. In relation to the UNCRC, there has not been prevarication. Fixing the bill is really complicated. We need to address, of course, the Supreme Court judgment. I think I go back to 2021, when this Parliament unanimously voted for that legislation. Of course, the UK government challenged that legislation, and we respect the outcome of the Supreme Court. But it's hugely important we now go back to fix the legislation to ensure we improve the rights of children and young people. And we do so as quickly as possible. Yes, there is a responsibility on this government, and our officials continue to engage. But, of course, there is also a responsibility on the part of the UK government, and I hope the member would respect that and acknowledge that.
Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Failure to close the poverty-related attainment gap, failure to amend the UN Convention of the Rights of the Child, failure to close the pupil-to-teacher ratio. Fewer teachers, fewer maths teachers, fewer English teachers, fewer classroom assistants, fewer primary, secondary and ASN schools, school buildings unsuitable for modern-day teaching, over 1,000 school buildings not inspected in the last 10 years, failure to reduce classroom sizes, violent attacks on our teachers, exodus of private and voluntary nursery staff, fewer childminders, 11,000 childminding places lost, not keeping the promise, entries in higher science subjects at a five-year low, entries in higher English and maths at a five-year low, teachers sidelined in education reforms, key recommendations on SQA reforms rejected, literacy and numeracy standards failing, curriculum for excellence and an unmitigated failure. Presiding Officer, there's clearly not enough time to go through the list of failures by this SNP government. Where are the laptops? Where are the bikes? Presiding Officer, this is a legacy of an SNP-run Scotland. So my question is simply this. What mess created by the Cabinet Secretary's predecessors will the Cabinet Secretary focus on first?
Cabinet Secretary.
To say, what a dispiriting question from Megan Gallagher. I don't really know where to start. No. Now, I met. Well, I spend a lot of my time, Presiding Officer, speaking to teachers, speaking to those who work with our children and young people. I spent a lot of time on Friday and on Saturday speaking to the Secondary Teachers Association at their conference and at NASWIT's conference in Aberdeen. And I think more broadly, it's really incumbent on all of us to remember this is about our children and young people and not to politicise yep. these issues, as the member has sought to do. Reading out a list of policy areas does in no way help to improve children's lives in Scotland. And talking about failure, in my view, is also not the place to start. Working constructively with government is the way in which we can improve children's lives.
Members.
That's why, of course, later this week, I will be meeting with Ms Gallagher's colleague. I will be meeting with my opposition counterpart in the Labour Party and in the Liberal Democrats. And I will work across party boundaries on this issue because it's absolutely important that we get this right for Scotland's children and young people.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Another area that the outgoing Children's Commissioner successfully challenged this government on was the age of criminal responsibility. In 2019, to much fanfare, the government changed it from the lowest in the world at 8 to just 12. And that, during the proceedings, you will remember, the United Nations Committee on the Rights of the Child uplifted the de minimis position of 12 to 14. We didn't even get to the bottom, and still there was celebration. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, is she content that we are still behind Russia and China in terms of the age at which we hold children criminally responsible for their actions? And when will her government address this so that we at least meet the very floor of international expectation?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question. I think there may be split ministerial responsibility in relation to the Justice Secretary on this matter. I recall some of the debates at the time on this issue in relation to the legislation. I'd be more than happy to write to him directly on the points he's raised.
Rona Mackay.
There should be no doubt Nicola Sturgeon has made huge progress putting in place the building blocks needed to end child poverty in Scotland. That's the assessment of Child Poverty Action Group Director John Dickey. But the Scottish Government is working with one hand tied behind its back. What analysis has the Scottish Government carried out into the impact of UK welfare reforms and how many children could be lifted out of poverty in Scotland if these key policies were reversed?
I thank Ms Mackay for her question. Again, I go back to my response to Ms Duncan Glancy. It's important we have context about the powers that this government has in this parliament and the external factors that are undoubtedly impacting on our children and young people. Now, our own analysis published in April of last year estimated that reversing key UK government welfare changes that have taken place just since 2015 could lift an estimated 70,000 people out of poverty, including 30,000 children in Scotland of this year. That's why we have consistently urged the UK government to match our ambitions in tackling child poverty head-on through reversing, for example, its policies such as the benefit cap and the child cap and the bedroom tax, and also introducing a similar game-changing benefit such as, of course, our Scottish child payment. I look forward to working with the UK government on these issues, recognising, of course, that responsibility for some of these powers rests in another parliament.
Question number two, Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to reduce violence in schools in light of reports that three teachers and a 14-year-old pupil have been injured in a disturbance at a Renfrewshire school.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny.
I hope the member will appreciate that I can't comment on the specifics of an ongoing police investigation. However, no teacher or member of staff should suffer verbal or physical abuse at their place of work. It is for schools and local councils to respond to specific instances of challenging behaviour. Notwithstanding, I have discussed this matter with the Association of Directors of Education only last week. I also chaired the Scottish Advisory Group on Relationships and Behaviour in Schools on Thursday with COSLA and with trade union representatives. We are currently gathering evidence that will help us better understand behaviour in our schools at a national level. That's through our Behaviour in Scottish Schools research, which we'll report by the end of this year. That will ensure future policy, guidance and support for our school staff reflects the current challenges in our schools, but also what's working well. And finally, I've been engaging with our trade union partners on this issue, most recently at the SSTA and NASWIC conferences held this weekend.
Jamie Green.
Naturally, I won't comment on the specifics of this case. We do wish those affected a speedy return to the classroom. But here's what I can comment on, and that's the sad reality that incidents like this are not unique. There have been 75,000 incidents of physical or verbal attacks by pupils against teachers and school staff over the last 5 years, and that doesn't include this year. Last year, there were nearly 20,000 such attacks, including 191 incidents involving the potential carrying of a dangerous item or weapon, and 64 were so serious they were actually reported to the police. Now, we have been raising this issue in this Parliament for years because the problem has been on the rise for years. Something has to change. My question, therefore, is this. What will change and when will it change?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Mr Green for his question. He will recognise, given my professional experience before I was an MSP, I take a very keen interest in this matter. As I mentioned, I think, in my initial response, this was raised at both teachers' conferences over the weekend. I think, fundamentally, we first of all need to recognise that COVID has changed the culture in our schools. Yes, that's changing relationships. It's changing behaviour. It's also changing things like attendance. There are broader changes happening within our school communities that we need to be cognisant of, and we need to better support our school staff, yes, to responding to those incidents when they become extreme. The second thing I would say to Mr Green is we also need to provide context. In my experience as a teacher, these examples that he has cited, of course, today are few. Yes, they happen, but they are not the norm in terms of behaviour that happens in our schools. And we need to be careful about how we characterise behaviour in our schools as politicians, because I think we don't want to send a message which is indifferent to the reality in our classrooms up and down the country, where teachers on a daily basis are equipped with the necessary skills and expertise to diffuse challenging situations as and when they happen in front of them. And the third thing I think I would say in response, Presiding Officer, is to remember when we're talking about a specific incidents, to be mindful we're talking about the impacts on staff, we're also talking about the impacts on our children and our young people. And as a teacher, I always think about that in relation to responding to incidents. And I think we just need to be careful as politicians not to use specific examples to form policy. That's why, in my initial response to the member, I talked about the national evidence base. Now, the last time that evidence was gathered was in 2016. It hasn't been updated as a result of the pandemic. I asked a number of weeks ago now for an update on that. I'm not able to get access to the data until autumn of this year. But, of course, at that time, I will share with Parliament the updated national picture in relation to behaviour in our schools.
Jamie Green.
I mean, the problem with that response is, with respect to the Cabinet Secretary, 75,000 is not few incidents. This is not a unique or isolated incident. It's in the tens of thousands. And if you don't believe me, listen to the EIS representing a body of teachers. Their former president, Heather Hughes, said that violent incidents are happening more and more in our schools because the young people and teachers are not getting the support they need. Nothing to do with COVID whatsoever. And she said that a year ago. The reality is that teachers are at their wits' end. They should not be afraid to go to work in the morning. And I agree, of course, it's other pupils and young people who have to bear the brunt of this disruption to their learning and, of course, their wider school experience. Now, I'm afraid to say The Cabinet Secretary is one of many education ministers we've had promising action on this. Saying it's just a matter for individual schools or councils simply doesn't wash anymore. This is a national problem which requires a national solution. So I'm asking, when will we see a comprehensive plan from this government to deal with rising violence in our schools?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question. He cites evidence from the EIS. Of course, I am formerly a member of the EIS. I recognise their views on this subject. I've spoken, of course, to the EIS on this matter already. And in fact, if the member has listened to any of the interviews I've given or actually some of my comments in relation to culture in our schools, he will know that this issue is really at the forefront of my mind in recognising how government can respond. But I suppose my point to the member is local authorities have a statutory responsibility at local level to deliver education in our schools. Therefore, they too have a responsibility in responding to extreme events. Now, I think it's really important that when extreme events occur, and I accept they do occur, although I would say they are not the norm in my experience, but I accept they do occur in our schools, that local authorities support their staff and support their young people in responding to those events. And that's what I'm working with COSLA on. I outlined in my initial response to the member the action I'm taking with COSLA, the action I'm taking in relation to the Zagrebus group, the action in relation to the behaviour in Scottish schools. Well, I hear Mr Kerr heckling from a sedentary position. I have to say, he probably wouldn't be able to do that in my classroom, but nonetheless, I've outlined my plan to the member. I've outlined my plan to the member, and Presiding Officer, I was going to go on to talk about promoting positive behaviour, so I looked to the Conservative benches with some hope and encouragement that they too might respond to that call. But more seriously, there is a request, I think, here. There is a call to action in relation to government, but also my point to the teaching unions this weekend, which was a call to the teaching workforce to tell me what they think is going to work in our schools. I don't claim to have all the answers in this as Cabinet Secretary, nor as a former teacher. I think the teaching workforce know exactly what they need in relation to the support and guidance that we provide them in schools. And yes, there's a level of that that we can provide at national level, but actually, our local authority partners will be key to tackling this.
I call Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer. It is right that the local authorities have a responsibility on this, but the interpretation of violent incidents varies across the whole of Scotland. That means bringing together these statistics is almost impossible, and that responsibility surely rests with the government. The Management of Health and Safety at Work Regulations 1999 states employers must carry out risk assessments to protect employees from exposure to reasonably foreseeable violence. So can the Cabinet Secretary say what discussions she's had with local authorities about improving these violent risk assessments so that she can compare like with like? And what discussions has she had about providing resources to support the mental health provisions for students at which mental health challenges lie at the base of a significant number of these conflicts that occur within school?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question. I think, as I alluded to in my response to Mr Green, I've already met with COSLA on this matter to talk about their role. I met most recently with them only last week as part of the Zagrebus Wider Behaviour Group. They co-chair that group with the government, and I've asked that group to come back with recommendations in relation to the action that we can take. The data that I alluded to, I think, in my response to Mr Green, will not be forthcoming until autumn. That's because of the data sets that our researchers have used, unfortunately. However, I do accept the need for government to act, but the government needs to act in partnership with our local authorities. So I think, more broadly, the member's point is an important one. Of course, in general, in terms of the points he makes around mental health and actually support for our young people, there is an issue there, and of course we have provided funding in relation to secondary schools having access to counselling services in the region of £16 million. But it's not just about specialists in our schools, it's also about our classroom teachers. It's also about our learning assistants and our behaviour support assistants, who are often paid much less than our classroom teachers. We need to recognise this is about a whole school response, a whole community response. And yes, that includes government, but it also, as the member has alluded to, includes our local authority partners. That's why I'm really keen to take this work forward with COSLA and our trade unions.
Willie Rennie.
I hope the Cabinet Secretary has got this at the top of her priority list, because teachers and pupils are sick to the back teeth of how they're being treated in our schools. It is a huge problem. I think it's causing massive issues with the management within our schools. Now, my real concern is that the last Cabinet Secretary didn't attend the advisory group back in December, and the survey she talked about won't be available until the autumn. I fear that the government aren't moving fast enough. There has been a mushrooming of cases since the pandemic. there has been a problem with mental health, the lack of resources, additional support needs. All of these issues should be at the top of our list. What can she say to reassure me that she fully understands the problem that exists in schools?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Mr Reddy for his question. He really doesn't need to tell me what teachers think. I spend most of my time, if I am not speaking to my political colleagues, speaking to my former friends and colleagues who work in education. They are very clear on telling me exactly what they think. And I very much recognise the challenge here, as I alluded to in my response to Mr Green. Of course, there is the wider national work. I think it's really important. And Mr Rennie previously, I think, an episode of First Minister's Questions, raised a specific case in his constituency. I think we need to be careful as politicians not to look at the specifics, but to look at the national picture. What is it telling us? And we don't yet have that data. We don't yet have that data because it hasn't been gathered since 2016. So I want to look at that data in more detail. The second point I make is that the Zagrebus work is really fundamental to this endeavour. It will work with COSLA, but it will also work with our trade union partners. And certainly on Saturday and Friday, I know there is a real encouragement from our trade union partners that they are part of the solution in identifying how we can better support our schools. So I hope that gives Mr Rennie a reassurance. I've spent much of my time as Cabinet Secretary over the course of the last 6 weeks looking at this issue, trying to get that granularity that we don't yet have. But it's important, as I say, that we don't look at the specifics necessarily of these extreme cases and that we instead look to support our local authority partners on the ground and help fundamentally to support those who work with our children and young people. So yes, teaching staff, but also learning support assistants, behaviour support assistants too.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions.